Can it be that we have made it to the last day of August? Yeah, like it or not, this is where we are. It's Thursday, August 31st, 2023, and this is Up North News Radio, and I'm Pat Kreitlow up here on Lake Wissota for our radio show that's going to get started at 6:06 in the morning, right after some news and commercials across the Civic Media Radio Network. What a show we've got here. The Republicans have introduced a new child care plan. I think we have to put plan in quotation marks, but we'll talk a bit about that. Kristen Lyerly will be joining us. We will also have her hometown health segment with a Green Bay physician talking about how she provides gender-affirming care to people. What exactly is gender-affirming care that we seem to hear so much about, that conservatives want so much to ban? And what is the actual health benefit of letting somebody be who they are? So we'll talk about that. The Brewers have now lost two in a row to the Cubs, so the division race is getting that much closer. And you probably already know this. There's a big, beautiful full moon out there across Wisconsin just ahead of a hot, hot weekend. So stick around if you're watching this later on video. You can run this thing ahead 4.5 minutes because the show will get started at 6:06. We will see you soon. Oh, Brewers tickets. We have Brewers tickets too.
Last night, Dr. Lyerly sent me a really good song for bumper music at some point.
Like today?
Maybe. I'm going to look and see if it would fit in any of the segments.
Okay. Oh, shoot. Still got to clip the Brewers in there. Alrighty, Brewers, where are you?
I think I skipped the part that's really good. At the beginning, he's like, things that make you go, hmm.
Okay. It's funky.
Things that make you go, hmm.
That's where it was.
Uh-huh.
Learned about kindergarten in Germany, where the idea was common. It wasn't in America, and her class grew so quickly, she had to move to a bigger space. Today, the building remains as a Watertown museum. So did you guess when kindergarten became part of the public school system in the state? It was 1898. But 42 years prior, the Schurz school.
Prior? Why does she keep saying prior?
I have no idea.
Okay.
I'm Terry Barr for the Civic Media Radio Network.
AM Radio provides always-on news, sports, talk, traffic, and weather reports. It also delivers vital emergency information when your community needs it most. A new bill in Congress would ensure AM Radio stays in your car. Because when cell and internet services are down, this free emergency service is critical. Text AM to 52886 and tell Congress to support the AM Radio for Every Vehicle Act.
I don't think I've ever heard that before.
You may receive up to 4 messages a month, and you may text stop to stop.
From anyone else, I mean.
By the National Association of Broadcasters.
All across Wisconsin from Civic Media, this is Up North News Radio. Now, live from our Lake Wissota studio, here's the founding editor of Up North News, Pat Breitlow.
Well, hey there, Wisconsin. Good morning. It's Thursday, August 31st. Yes, it is. Last day of August. September is on the doorstep. And it's another beautiful day to have you here up north from wherever you're listening across the Civic Media Radio Network, on social media, on the Civic Media app, and more. Glad to have you here in the state of Wisconsin Sense, where we unpack the news each morning. Here's a little bit of what's on tap this morning. We're going to start with, again, Wisconsin political notes and the ongoing effort to try to get Republican legislators to understand just how dire the childcare crisis has become in the state. And it appears they may be have heard something about it. It's been mentioned a few times because yesterday Republicans revealed a new plan for childcare, and it is woefully inadequate. Now, again, we have a party that has already proposed to address the labor shortage by putting more kids into the workforce. I mean, you can't get them out of the classroom and into bars serving liquor fast enough, right? So now, instead of using a record surplus to address the child care shortage, the proposal is to pack more kids into each classroom and reduce the age at which teenagers can watch younger children without supervision. So basically, the answer is, put the kids into the coal mines, and the ones who are too young to swing a pickaxe, we'll put the child care center in the mines too. Something like that. We'll talk a bit more about the details coming up. In our second hour, we have Hometown Health. There is a lot of ugly pushback out there these days over notions like inclusivity, diversity, acceptance. But the reason the pushback is out there and why it's become so ugly is because something stronger is doing some pushing of its own, the right to be yourself. And sometimes people need some guidance in getting to where they think they belong as themselves versus what was assigned to them at birth. And that's where the topic of gender-affirming care comes in. And we'll talk to a family practice physician in Green Bay about the care that goes into gender-affirming care, which seems to be rubbing some people in such a wrong way. We'll also talk to Luke Mathers, and with his blessing, we have Brewers tickets yet again. Brewers are coming back home to American Family Field for games this weekend. Today and tomorrow, we will be giving away tickets to Sunday afternoon's game. At least that's the assignment that we're going to give to Aaron Zommers down in Madison at the Civic Media Control Center at the top of State Street near the Capitol Square. Mr. Zommers, how are you?
I'm doing well, Pat.
I think that, in fairness, Luke did say now it's Labor Day weekend. You know, maybe people already have plans. They might not use the tickets. And Luke, to his credit, did say, you know, maybe you'd want to use the tickets. And I said, thank you. But I already have plans up here on Lake Wissota for the weekend. And didn't even think about you, Aaron. I just completely, you know, goofed that one up. So if you want to use these tickets, tell all of our listeners right now, and they're all yours for Sunday. break their
I'm
hearts.
I'm going to deny everyone the privilege to get them. No, I'm kidding. I'm good. I have some plans. So I'm going to go hang out with some friends, go camping.
Nice. Well, you got the weekend for it in terms of, I mean, you're not going to get a drop of rain. It's going to be warm. Well, some would say hot, but if you're camping, you know, you're not going to, you know, be chattering your teeth there in your sleeping bag. So I think that's going to work out well for you. And how did you like the super moon? You know, it was bright, really, really bright.
Was it? I don't know. I went to bed early enough that I didn't really see it.
Oh, no. I meant on your way into work. You didn't see it there at all?
Oh. Yeah, I could.
I suppose in the city, and the trees and the streetlights, you probably didn't notice it. But, oh, yeah, this morning still, it was super bright. And we had something happen, and I don't think it's a coincidence that there was a super bright full moon. We've never heard an owl in our backyard before. And right about the time we were getting set to go to bed, you know, we had the windows open and we hear this hoo, 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 hoo. I mean, it was just unmistakable. And we thought, well, this is wild. We've been here on the lake 28 years. We've never heard an owl. And the owl just continued to hoot, you know, from one of the trees in our backyard. And then it dawned on us. This year, we have had more little rabbits in our backyard than ever before. It's like there was a population explosion. Bunnies everywhere. And they're cute and everything. But I mean, bunnies everywhere. And then it occurred to us, we're like, we haven't seen any bunnies in the backyard for a day or two.
That would be why the owl's there.
I think the owl was kind of hooting like, I'm so full. I can't possibly eat another. And, you know, or he was complaining like, oh, I'm so full, but look how bright the moon is. I can hunt like crazy. Nobody can hide from me. So if I do see any bunnies out here today, I'll just be like, psst, you got a new neighbor. I'd lay low for a little while, you know.
Gotta wish him some luck.
It was a little bit of a Wild Kingdom thing that we've got going on here. So that was pretty cool. There's our moment of nature, our moment of up north nature for you. So we will get the full details of the forecast from Weatherology coming up. And then along the way, of course, you can always join us at 844-967-2789. You can call that number. You can text that number. We'll see that and read off your text. You can also watch us on Facebook, comment on the live video feed there, and we may put the comment up on screen as well. And one more reminder, we did do a back-to-school edition of our daily newsletter. You can get a look at it, even if you're not a subscriber, by going to upnorthnewswi.com and clicking on the story about our special back-to-school edition of our daily newsletter. All right, we'll take a break. We'll talk about the Brewers wrapping up their series with the Cubs, and we'll unpack the news coming up next. Wherever you're listening across Wisconsin on this beautiful Thursday morning, when you're here, you're up north. We'll be right back.
For those of you watching the stream, on this, the 31st of August, if you're like me and you haven't paid September's rent yet, do that today. Do that now.
Yes. Pay your rent.
Multi-story building at 710 West Historic Mitchell Street will serve as the mesmerizing backdrop for the show. Nightlight will feature a fashion show, a variety of local vendors, dance performances, and music. After sundown, the event will set the grounds alight with an amazing motion graphic show. Families with children will have plenty of options to indulge in memory-making activities throughout the festival's run, including a life-size light bright wall and a hands-on multilingual exhibit presented by PNC Bank. The event is family-friendly and free to the public. Don't miss this iconic event, Nightlight, presented by Joy Engine, where art comes to life. Log on joyengine.org. That's joyengine.org.
If I could be you.
And you could be me.
For just 1 hour.
If you could find a way.
To get inside.
Each other's mind.
Walk a mile in my shoes.
Walk a mile in my shoes.
Walk a mile in my shoes.
We've all felt left out. And for some, that feeling lasts more than a moment. We can change that. Learn how at belongingbeginswithus.org. Brought to you by the Ad Council.
Walk a mile in my shoes.
Think you'd like working with us at Civic Media? We're having fun and moving fast to preserve hometown radio across Wisconsin. If you have the right skills to join our team, let's talk. Civic Media is a proud equal opportunity employer committed to diversity and inclusion, along with the growth and development of all current and future employees. If you're interested or are part of an organization who wants to know,
It's a marvelous night for a moon dance with the stars up above in your eyes.
This is a very happy coincidence as we wish a happy birthday to Van Morrison, who turns 78 years old today. And of course, Moondance is arguably the most classic of his many classics. Well, the Brewers had that 9-game winning streak, and then, the wheels kind of fell off the bus here in a couple of really close games to the Cubs, and losing them in heartbreaking fashion. We talked yesterday about how on Tuesday's game, the wind was blowing in, and despite some very hard-hit balls, the Brewers just could not get on the board. And then yesterday, in the finale of the 3-game series, the Brewers were in a position to keep the game competitive. They'd been down 2-0. They came back and tied it 2-2. And then in the 8th inning, it started with a rare error at shortstop by Willie Adames. And then with runners on base, Cody Bellinger drove in the tie-breaking run for the Cubs with a ricochet right off the ankle of Brewers pitcher Yoel Piamps. It would have been an easy, had it not hit his ankle, it would have come to Adames. He would have thrown the runner out, and it still would have been a tie game heading into the 9th inning. But instead, it ricocheted off Piamps' ankle, went over to the third baseman, Andrew Monasterio, who just could not get the throw there in time for the speedy Bellinger. It allowed Mike Toshman to score from third. It was the third hit of the game for the Cubs, but enough for them to beat the Brewers 3-2. And so now they come back to American Family Field for a 3-game series with the Phillies, and we will have tickets to Sunday afternoon's game. We'll have 2 to give away later this hour, and 2 more to give away tomorrow. We'll have a Brewers trivia question at about 6:50 for you to answer, so stick around for that. Let's see, I wanted to get to, temperature, 6 a.m. temperatures around the area here. It is 47 degrees up here on Lake Wissota. It is 46 in Madison. Waukesha coming in at 45. La Crosse, 51 degrees on their way to a high of 80. Wausau is at 47, and the forecast high there will be 76 degrees. Again, more from Weatherology coming up an hour from now. And I was going to start by talking about the new Republican plan for childcare. I see Mark from the SAC is already locked and loaded and ready to go on this. So, Mark, do you want to share some of your thoughts on what's happening on the childcare crisis issue in the Capitol before I get into details on the Republican plan? Good morning.
Well, I haven't heard the details of the Republican plan yet, but the clues I've been given, I think that it's probably reducing the age, of course, of kids being able to watch over kids. But it seems to me that these Republicans want to have it two ways. They want to have kids working in the workforce right away, but they don't want them exposed to any new ideas at all. They want to protect it. They want to isolate them from ideas, put them to work right away. And, in other states, they want to raise it, lower the age of consent. Mm-hmm. That it is just getting to be ridiculous here. It's like in some ways they want to do away with childhood because get those kids as soon as they can into the workforce, like they did back in the old days where we actually established childhood for kids. I mean, that kids were able to maintain some kind of childhood up until a little bit older age. That we have in our modern society here. You just wonder what new evil they're going to hatch, day by day, because they do it nationally now with their national networks, and that it is just getting to be ridiculous. I mean, that we don't want to pay for taking care of the kids, and and it is just
and just get them into the workforce, rather than
get them into the workforce.
Yeah, to do what we want to do with them rather than letting them learn about the world and then decide from there. So yeah, I'll give the details from here, Mark. Thanks so much. Have a great day,
brother.
All right. So here's the deal: Republicans have been hearing for months and months from their own constituents, from their own Republican voting constituents, that there is a real issue here, a real shortage of childcare. We have a worker shortage in Wisconsin, in part because a parent, quite often the mom, not always, but a parent has to stay home, has to leave a good job because there either isn't childcare available or it's become so expensive that it is more cost effective for a parent to drop out of the workforce, which I know for some Republicans have talked a lot about. That's the way that it should always be in their mind, but that's not their decision to make. Regardless, they have heard that there's an issue here. They also know that the Biden administration during the pandemic, to help essential workers stay on the job where they were so sorely needed, the pandemic relief packages that were out there included money to go to childcare centers to help them stay open and to help parents afford childcare. So again, that essential work could get done in this country, something you think Republicans would like and be in favor of. Well, that federal money is running out. Governor Evers is looking at a multi-billion-dollar surplus and saying, hey, why don't we take some of this and start up our own child care assistance program, because that's tax money. Working parents pay their taxes. This could be one use for that tax money, is to keep child care affordable, keep more people in the workplace, have kids be at child care centers that are adequately staffed and safe with trained supervision. Republican legislators have heard all this. They know all of this. And yet they have decided instead to go in a couple of different directions here. One, instead of using your tax dollars for things like helping address the worker shortage and affordable child care, they want to use your tax dollars for more tax giveaways to the very rich. And then yesterday came the new Republican plan on child care. And you could almost predict it without me saying a word. It was based first on deregulation, which of course is just another way of saying remove certain protections for consumers, for employees, for the environment, for kids. And at the center of the Republican child care proposal is deregulation, things that would do things, for example, reduce or adjust the ratio of providers to kids and adjust the maximum group sizes in a child care center and in a classroom. In other words, more kids under each, you know, teacher or provider in each room. And another provision would reduce the age at which somebody in a child care center could watch kids alone. They would lower that age from 18 to 16. So 16-year-olds could independently supervise children alone. In other words, children watching children. Rather than take care of the adults, make sure they're trained in first aid and certified and competent, their deal is to warehouse kids, pack more of them in, and have them watched by increasingly younger and perhaps less well-trained providers. One of the blogs I like to read is one called Jake's Wisconsin Funhouse. And as he was looking at the proposal from State Senator Dewey Strobel of Cedarburg, he referred to it as the Megamart solution. That's essentially what they want to do, is create these Megamarts and warehouse the kids in there rather than actually providing assistance to the child care centers and to the parents. And as Governor Evers has noted originally and in calling for a special session next month, that if Republicans don't address the child care crisis, a recent report estimates that more than 2,000 providers might close their doors and go out of business. That would mean a loss of about 4,800 child care jobs, affecting 87,000 children. And how many of their parents will, again, need to either leave the labor force and exacerbate the worker shortage, or put their kids in supervision that isn't as safe, that isn't as educational. Now, of course, the Republican position is, you know, filled with hypocrisy about how you know, we don't need child care plans that amount to a cash handout for businesses. Hello, Foxconn. If you're going to target a particular business or a business sector for aid, how about the one in your district? Because there are plenty of Republican districts that have a lot of child care centers that are struggling and would potentially close. But after Strobel talks about, you know, the cash handout to businesses, he writes, family situations vary, but is it right to ask everyone, including those who make financial trade-offs to be a one-income household, to subsidize the child care costs of middle and upper-income families? Oh, please. Are you trying to tell me that after proposing a tax plan that benefits the highest tax bracket, and now this week you rewrote the plan, you fixed it, you said, because now it only puts most of its relief in the second highest tax bracket, but you're going to tell me your position on child care is, oh, we can't be subsidizing the child care of upper income families? I mean, that's disingenuous is the nicest way to put it. And to take a shot at single parent families and families where, you know, only where both parents have to work by saying, you know, the financial trade-offs that some families make to be a one-income household. I mean, talk about holier than thou. I mean, what kind of a luxury is it these days for some families to even have the discussion that a parent gets to stay at home? It is almost entirely driven by dire financial straits, and yet Republicans love to frame this as a choice. And these same folks who say, well, you know, the nuclear family with, you know, dad working and mom staying at home is the best one. And yet, if we provide any assistance to that family, we're now paying that parent to be lazy? We're paying these parents to sit at home on the couch? They can't keep having it both ways. And yet, that's exactly what they keep trying to do, is not give you a serious child care plan and not give you a serious tax cut plan. They've simply warmed over the things that Governor Evers has already vetoed and have said, well, the governor is forcing us to come into a special session. No, that's your decision to come in or not come in and either address the issue or not. So you still have time. You have about 3 weeks before the special session comes in. And perhaps take these next couple of weeks and listen more to your constituents. All right, we'll come back and talk more about Wisconsin headlines and much more. Brewers tickets in our next half hour as well. You're up north.
On a magic night. Can I just have one moment dance with you, my love?
What was that? You had me very freaked out there.
Bringing it up so early? Yeah. Sorry about that.
Yeah, okay. I was like, I kept looking at the clock going, I know I'm tired, but did I forget math?
No, for Todd's show, I start at 30 seconds from the end instead of a minute from the end, usually. And so I normally start fading that up immediately. So I started doing it and I was like, ah, crap. Well, I'm not just going to pull it back down. That'll be weirder.
Okay. Hey, lady.
Hi. Sure.
Hey.
Things that make you go,
It's good, right?
Well, it was 30 years ago. Yeah. I mean, did you like just hear that song for the first time or?
No, I was walking through the airport yesterday and it was playing at some bar and I thought, well, that's fun radio music.
It is fun radio music.
Uh-huh. Right. So I sent it to Aaron.
Okay.
And I'm sure Aaron was like, what
he was all over it. He was ready to go.
Oh, yeah. I definitely have never heard it before, but I think it it works for, I don't know, it could work for like a segment with Republican childcare stuff, like, or anything that they're doing that makes you go,
True.
Mm-hmm.
All righty.
And although you've never heard it before, I bet our audience has.
I'm sure, yeah.
Oh, yeah. All right. What do we got? 2 minutes here. Look at you back for a minute or two at least.
Yeah, I've been home for about 12 hours and I'm going to leave shortly.
Okay. Well, give me a shout if you're in the area.
Thanks.
All right. Let's see. And it's,
I'm in a big rush to get to the tailgate, you know.
Oh, that's right. Oh, such decisions you have to make today. Kind of thought you'd have a Duran Duran t-shirt on or something for us this morning. Ah, yes, the other event.
It wasn't in America, and her class grew so quickly, she had to move to a bigger space.
Although I do have a Duran Duran t-shirt in my closet. Oh, speaking of t-shirts, which one should I order?
I don't know. I got a couple of them here for you, so I can hand them over if you want. So.
Okay.
I'm Terry Barr for the Civic Media Radio Network.
I'm Smokey Bear, and I made an assistant to help you out because only you can.
I think you should get them all because actually, the reason they're laid out the way they are, it's a calendar. It slots right in. You got your Monday through Friday.
Yeah, there you go. Yes.
Don't just toss them out. I have a bubbler story.
Oh, okay.
Mm-hmm.
Well, good. Now we've got something to kick off with.
I don't have a specific story. I just have calling it that in college and people being like, huh?
That's my bubbler story.
Okay.
At least my college was in Wisconsin. So
here we go. We got the drums going for Gina Schock, drummer for the Go-Go's. She is 66 years old today. More birthdays and a history lesson coming up in just a bit. Up North News apparel is here, t-shirts and tote bags. Head over to the homepage, upnorthnewswi.com. Click store in the top banner and get yourself a t-shirt or two or three. Kristen Lyerly is where are you? It doesn't appear to be Arizona. It does not appear to be northern Minnesota. Wait a minute. Are you in your own home for the first time like this summer?
I'm home and it feels so good.
Wow. How long are you there for?
About 18 hours.
Good job, buddy. You. Remember when you used to like your family? My goodness. It's the summer of Kristen road trips continues here.
I do like my family. And after Labor Day weekend, which is a big weekend for me to work, I'm going to be home for over a week. And
all
I
right.
can't wait.
That's okay. Again, you got these boys who are independent and, you know, they're out from under mom's thumb. So I'm sure it's been a good time for them. So more
and
traveling.
One of them starts high school today.
Oh, really?
Yes. And he has suddenly discovered the magic of hygiene.
Now, wait, by hygiene, though, do you mean like what we would all normally do? Or do you mean like a lot of teenage boys, like 20, 25 minutes have gone by and you're like, get out of the shower.
I have one of those, too. But no, he suddenly wants his hair cut and he wants to wear clean clothes and it's a shower every day. And this is a new thing.
Well, I think you should embrace that. should encourage that. It's, you know what? He's probably seen just enough of those Old Spice commercials now that he wants to be among the cool kids. We were showing the t-shirts off earlier before. You said you have a bubbler story, referencing our bubbler t-shirt.
Oh, yeah. So when we were off the air, we were talking about the Up North t-shirts, and there's this great bubbler t-shirt. And Aaron and I both have stories about how we went to college and used the word bubbler. So for me, because I went to Minnesota, I was a freshman at this like orientation dance, and I didn't know anybody, and I was super thirsty and I didn't want any punch. So I walked over to some of the supervisors, the upperclassmen, and I said, "Hey, do you guys know where the bubbler is?"
And being from Minnesota, I can already tell you what the answer was.
They all just looked at each other and laughed at me. It was so humiliating.
What?
But now I go back and I'm like, "Where's your bubbler, you know, to drink from?" Now I can own it.
I will tell you this much. Having come to this side of the river for all of my adult life, I use soda as often, as interchangeably as I do pop. Before I was like all pop until I moved over to Wisconsin. But I can tell you I've never used the word bubbler. I probably never will because it's called a drinking fountain. A bubbler is what Lawrence Welk had to make the little bubbles, you know, before his show with the champagne music. At least that's what every Minnesota native will tell you, Aaron.
Yeah, and you know, being from Manitowoc, it's pretty close to Sheboygan and therefore Kohler, the home of the bubbler. So it makes sense that I call it that. I went to Lawrence University, which is in Wisconsin, in Appleton. So at least people knew what I was talking about when I said that. And I wasn't so out of the loop as to know that it really is a drinking fountain and that that's okay to call it that. However, if somebody from out of state called it a water fountain, I was like, no, a water fountain is what's in the middle of the park that you
throw coins
tell your
into
kids
that
not to go in.
Yes, exactly. So we've got our definitions down, but poor Kristen had to put up with this going to college at the University of Minnesota, where she's heading later today and faces a true dilemma because of me. I was the one that let her know that, yeah, you could go to the Gophers tailgate thing, you know, football game and everything, but just down the road, like 5 minutes, is the Minnesota State Fairgrounds, and who's playing at the State Fair tonight, Kristen?
It's Duran Duran.
Now you've got to choose your college buddies or the loves of your life. What are you going to do later today when you get out there?
I'm going to have to make a game time decision, Pat.
I see that. Yeah. I think you can do both. You know, the tailgate will be there. The concert, you know, neither one of them lasts 5 minutes. They both go on for a little bit. Mm-hmm. And I think you could be in for a very enjoyable kind of evening.
It could be
as
a life-changing
Aaron brings up
evening.
A little Duran Duran underneath here. I half expected you were going to be in the, you know, like a Duran Duran concert t-shirt, but you're in your U of M cheering attire instead.
I'm ready to tailgate.
Mm-hmm. Yes, you are. Who are the Gophers playing?
Nebraska. So hopefully will be a good game for the Gophers.
Speaking of Nebraska, though, did you see at the football stadium there last night? 92,000 people to see the Nebraska women's volleyball team play against Omaha so that they could set the record for the single largest crowd ever at a women's sports event. 92,000 people to see a volleyball match.
That's incredible.
That is amazing. And we've talked the last year and more about women's volleyball, and especially at the collegiate level, is just has really taken off. And look, I can make all the jokes that there's nothing better to do in Nebraska anyway, but still, if you're going to brave a crowd of 90,000, it's because you are entertained by that, you know, as much as a football game.
My college friends in Minnesota actually have season tickets to women's volleyball, and we all know how great the Wisconsin volleyball team is. Let's get on board. Let's do this.
Not just Wisconsin, like UW-Eau Claire up here. They were national champions a year ago. Mm-hmm. So this is something that we'll be talking about much more as that sport continues to grow. So, you know, good on them for doing that. I should mention for folks that are saying, hey, it's Thursday, where's Joe Zepecki? The same place where Melissa Baldoff was yesterday. The two of them are a thing, you might know. And they are on a little family trip this week. They will both be back next week. So it was nice of Kristen to come in and pinch hit. And in fact, I don't know if Aaron might have stepped out of the control room here, but he was talking to somebody about you. And somebody was saying, oh, yeah, Kristen, she's on, you know, once a week with Kristen Bryan on As Goes Wisconsin. And I think once a week with Up North News. And Aaron, what was your bigger smart alecky response? Like, oh, no, it's not just once a week.
It's not once a week. It's basically as often as she wants to. And she's more than welcome.
Yes, it's pretty much on demand. Like if a little slot opens on the video monitor, like, oh, Kristen's got something to say. All right. Here's...
Whenever you open that door, Pat, I just walk right through it.
I know. Well, I'll tell you the other thing, and I haven't talked to Kristen Bry about this, but I'm going to be in a few weeks here. I'm going to be taking off for a week to visit with family and doing a little road trip. And I thought, boy, would it be great if for one of those days, you know, Kristen Lyerly and Kristen Bry could just take over the show for a day. And then I remembered that that week is pretty much Kristen Bry's due date, as she's now entering what I'm sure feels like her 14th month of pregnancy at this point. And I thought that might be a little risky. I mean, look, we all like a little bit of drama on local radio, but I'm not sure that a live childbirth would necessarily be the way to go for morning radio. But
it would probably be more entertaining than the medical emergencies that we're seeing now on live TV with Mitch McConnell.
Oh my gosh. Yeah. That was, I mean, it was... Look, I am not a Mitch McConnell fan. I get that. And there's been many times I've said some very nasty things about him, you know, like stealing the Supreme Court seat and all that. Mm-hmm. But from the standpoint of basic human decency, I don't take any joy in watching him again yesterday completely freeze up for a good 30 seconds on camera. People coming up to him, Senator, are you okay? Senator, do you want to go for a walk? And it's just so wrong. And look, I have said previously, I hope that when I get to be of a certain age, that if people that love me and respect me come up and say, Pat, it's time, that I don't go, oh no, I am completely irreplaceable. I must stay here. And I think the same has to be said for both Mitch McConnell and Dianne Feinstein from California. Mm-hmm. Both of them need to know when to start singing Happy Trails, you know?
Yeah. It's scary. And you have to wonder if that's happening when he's on TV in front of the camera, what's mm-hmm. happening in the rest of his life?
Yeah. I mean, Aaron, you have to watch this as a younger person and just wonder who's in charge, you know?
Yeah, it's that kind of thing can be terrifying. And I'm mm-hmm. sure, yeah, it really sucks to have to do that, to admit you can't do something. Mm-hmm. And not everybody has to deal with that younger if they don't have like a disability or some kind of mental illness or something. But eventually, sometimes you just have to say, all right, I can let someone else take this responsibility now.
Yeah. You'd like to know that. I'd like to think that I'll know to do that. There's never a guarantee. But boy, when it happens on national TV a couple of different times, you'd like to think that something's going to be said there. And look, I get that maybe he thinks he's the only one that can keep that group together because he's looking over at the House of Representatives mm-hmm. and Kevin McCarthy, who cannot keep that circus, you know, inside the tent. And maybe he wonders if the same thing would happen in the Senate. But at some point, you look at that circus and you go, you know, it's time for me to say, not my circus, not my monkeys. It's time for something else.
Well, no matter what your leadership position is, whether you are the leader of the Senate or the leader in your local community group, you always have to be thinking about who comes behind you and what kind of a group of leaders are you cultivating to form the future of the organization that you're leading. You know, it could be your school board. It could be your assembly seat. It doesn't matter. It's all about your community. It's all about your people. So for somebody to hang on so desperately because they don't think that there's somebody else there in the wings, there definitely is. You just have to find that person and make sure that they're ready when the time comes.
And, you know, ready or not, you have to have that not just that faith in them and in, you know, whatever system you're leaving, but at some point you have to do that for yourself. It's mm-hmm. just to say, you know what, it is time for that. But before we leave politics entirely here, obviously in the last segment, I went on about the new, quote unquote, Republican plan, quote unquote, to address childcare, which I first saw in comments from one of your assembly reps over there, John Mako, saying that, you know, some big ideas for childcare were coming soon. And I put up online at the time saying, I don't think these are going to be big ideas. I think they're going to be the same warmed over ideas. And I guess it even was worse than I thought in terms of saying, well, let's just stuff more kids in each room and let's let more teenagers watch more children unsupervised. It's just an absolutely unserious effort. And it's a way of saying, you know what, we're gerrymandered, we're in the majority, and we don't want to help anybody except the very rich. So, you know, they have no problem sending this big middle finger to parents and childcare providers statewide.
I would love to see them sitting together in a room as they're coming up with these ideas. Like, we've got to put something out there and we've got to use all of the Republican talking points. So how can we talk about less government, but also talk about more regulation and sell it to our people? And they accomplished that, I think, with this plan.
Oh, yeah. It's a bingo card. You know, yeah. They just have to check all of the boxes. Kind of like yesterday, for folks that missed it, I was talking about how State Senator Van Wongard wants to change the regulation for roadside zoos because one uses and, you know, gets their accreditation from a place that's pretty responsible. But there's this bill that says, well, if they get their accreditation from this other group, you know, that's okay too, even though that group has a much lower record in terms of standards and things. And here's Van Wongard giving the Republican talking point of, well, we just want to see parity and less regulation. We don't need, you know, two separate standards. Yeah, you do. Yes, you do. If you have two different standards from accreditation and one of them is Fred's Zoo Licensing Emporium, yeah, you do treat that one differently. But again, it doesn't match the conservative talking point of cutting red tape rather than actually serving anything from animals to small children. Or sometimes I get the two confused, but regardless, it's on.
Spoken like a grandfather.
It's on our elected officials to actually try to address the real life problems that we have here. So anyway, that was the latest thing on the childcare. And we've heard their new plan on the tax cut. That's what I was trying to say. Their new tax cut plan, which is a warmed over version of that as well. So I think we maybe for a minute and a half had some expectations for a fall legislative session. But now I think because we're being disappointed on childcare, we're being disappointed on tax cuts. I think the only thing we can hang our hats on now is, you know, that maybe there will be a Brewers stadium deal. But even then, because that really should happen this fall, but I don't know that it will. So, all right, well, there's our little look at the legislature coming up ahead of the fall session. We're going to do today's history lesson and music break coming up. Oh, and Brewers tickets. You can win Brewers tickets next. You're up north. It's Thursday. Thursday, I'm a little bit more tired. Thursday, it's a little tougher to do math. The last segment, my math was right, even though Aaron was bringing up the music. And this time around, I was like, oh, wait, yeah, it's time for a commercial. All right. I was just getting set to transition into something else. And I'm like, oh, wait, numbers.
The cues are very helpful to me because I just cannot keep the numbers in my head.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Well, good. Mm-hmm. Good, good, good.
I don't know how you do all the things all at the same time.
I don't know. I'm helping
very carefully. I'm sure it's years of practice.
That's all it is. It's old age. It's just years of practice. I was a good friend of mine is hoping to start a podcast. And so he was talking to me this week about all the things that he would need to know to start a podcast. And at some point, as I was going through all these different things, he kind of says the same thing. He's like, how do you keep all this stuff in your head? How do you know all of these things? I said, you have to understand, that's all I know. I have no mechanical skills whatsoever. I have no athletic skills whatsoever. There's just certain things, and I just stay in my lane, and I just call for help on everything else. So if somebody can get some help from me on what little tiny bit I know, then I've done my job.
You know yourself.
Know yourself. That's mm-hmm. That is so, so true. Okay, let's get to this. Okay. Oh. Where's my note about George Harrison?
What about George Harrison?
Oh, he's our first thing here.
Oh.
Oh.
I like George Harrison. I like the Beatles. I'm a Beatles fan.
I knew I liked you for a good reason.
So who's your Beatle person?
Paul.
I'm a John girl.
You're a John girl? I'm a Paul guy? All right.
Look at how we make beautiful music together, Pat.
I know. At some point, we invite the listeners in to say, well, we're just talking about favorite Beatles. Pay no never mind to us. It was on this day in 1976 that George Harrison was found guilty of, quote, subconscious plagiarism for this song. Can you hear the plagiarism?
I can't remember which song it was.
The Chiffons. He's so fine.
Yeah.
He's so fine. No, it's not.
Subconscious plagiarism.
Subconscious plagiarism.
Or musical influence. Call it what you will.
Yes, or as we call it today, sampling. We're sampling. That's what we're doing. We're paying tribute. Anyway, so 1976, this day is when that happened. Hey, before we do anything else, I think we should get set to give away some Brewers tickets. This is always the point where we increase the degree of difficulty for Aaron to run this show, because not only is he going to be hitting some buttons to play some songs in a second, he's going to be taking your phone calls at 844-967-2789. Remember, you cannot have won anything in the calendar month of August. The tickets to Sunday's Brewers-Phillies game must be emailed to you.
Actually, you can have one in the calendar month of August, because this game takes place in September and we do it by the game. So it's basically reset unless you've already won tickets for this weekend.
Well, there you go. Look at this. Everybody's in. It's an all skate. Here we go. First correct answer. 844-967-2789. Two tickets to Sunday afternoon's game at American Family Field. How many Milwaukee Brewers have won a league batting title for highest batting average? We've had a lot of great hitters over the years. There's Christian Yelich, there's Cecil Cooper, Ryan Braun, Robin Yount. I mean, the list goes on and on. Prince Fielder. How many Brewers have won a league batting title for highest average? I will say this much. It's probably not much of a hint, but you know, you can fit it on one hand, you know, the correct answer. But first correct answer, just give me the number. How many Brewers have won a league batting title at 844-967-2789, and you're going to win two tickets to Sunday's Brewers game. All right, let's see. One of my favorite albums came out this day in 1999 as the Chicks, formerly the Dixie Chicks, released their second major label album, Fly, with tracks like Ready to Run. Still listen to this album top to bottom. It's just good. And they've had some shows in the area here lately. Minnesota State Fair and Madison, right? I think they were recently.
I've seen a lot of friends who have gone to the Chick shows recently on Facebook. Fun yep. show.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think they were in Madison. I wanted to go, but I realized too late.
Yeah. Anyway, still just a favorite. Sad anniversary. This day in 1997 was when Diana, Princess of Wales, and her partner and driver were killed in a car crash in Paris. We did birthdays already for Van Morrison, who is 78 years old today. Bob Welch is also 78, guitarist for Fleetwood Mac. And here's one you may not know, the name Glenn Tilbrook. I didn't know the name Glenn Tilbrook. I knew Squeeze was one of those bands that I really like. I didn't know the lead singer's name. It's Glenn Tilbrook, and he is 66 years old today, born in 1957 in Woolwich, London, England. Here's another birthday, 53 years old. This one's going to knock you down, kids. 53 years old for Debbie Gibson, born in Brooklyn, New York.
Mm-hmm.
Had nice little teeny bopper songs like this one. And while we wait for her to come up, we'll mention that we already said that Gina Shook, the dancer for the Go-Go's, or not dancer, drummer for the Go-Go's, is 66. And Tony DeFranco of the DeFranco family, he is 63 years old today. Debbie Gibson one of those where you'd sing into your hairbrush, you know, in the mirror? Or?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
She was actually really, I mean, she was accused of being very bubblegum, which she kind of is, but she wrote her songs, she performed her songs. She was actually really very accomplished for a young woman.
And then accomplished on Broadway as well, either for a time or still is. I'm not sure.
Yeah, she's still around.
Yep.
She's still performing.
Before we get to the last song, I'm going to tell you again that tickets are still available for the Brewers. First correct answer at 844-967-2789. How many Milwaukee Brewers have won a league batting title for highest batting average? And I'm also going to tell you, we're not going to carry this over into the next hour because this is a pretty easy answer. You just got to basically, it's an answer 1 through 5. And so if we don't give away the tickets here in the next few minutes, we will carry that over till tomorrow and we'll make it 4 tickets that we're going to give away. On this day in 2004, Green Day released the title track of their new album, American Idiot. Which I have to tell you, running a talk show on a progressive radio station, it is way too tempting to use this as bumper music over and over and over again.
It was especially a simpler time back then.
It's especially tempting for me because this album is one of the main reasons that I play the drums.
Is it really?
Yeah, I don't know. Huh. It's simple but effective drumming on most of the songs, and their previous album, Dookie, made me want to play bass, and this one made me want to play drums, and I love both.
I know that this weekend, we're not going to be on the air for it, but one of the 8 music anniversaries this weekend is Kelly Clarkson winning American Idol. I would have thought you said Kelly Clarkson and, like, Since You've Been Gone or something was going to be what got you to play drums. I really saw you as more of a Kelly Clarkson drummer than a Green Day drummer, but
I don't know. If that's
He's like, I know I can't swear on the radio, but can I give you an obscene gesture through the video here? I don't know.
See you, Aaron, as more of an Alanis Morissette drummer.
Oh, there. That's a good way to split the difference there.
Uh-huh.
That's good.
There we go.
Kristen, you've got this. You know this.
Yes, I do.
Anyway, American Idiot was a single that was released 3 weeks before the album was issued. The song and the album were widely successful, highly acclaimed, each nominated for multiple Grammy Awards, and the album won the Grammy for Best Rock Album. All right, last time I'm going to mention this. First correct answer at 844-967-2789. How many Milwaukee Brewers have won a league batting title? And if we get an answer in the next 5 minutes or so, you'll win 2 tickets to Sunday afternoon's Brewers game against the Phillies. If not, we'll carry it over. We'll give away 4 tickets tomorrow. Kristen, you want to tell us quick? We had to pre-tape Hometown Health. That's coming up at 7:30. You want to give us a very quick idea of what it's about?
Yeah, we're going to talk with Dr. Melissa Hitty up here in Green Bay, who provides gender-affirming care. So she's going to talk about, who comes to see her and what that experience is like.
Yeah, all about, being you and being true to you, despite the pushback that's out there these days. Sometimes it's good to actually have the right to be yourself. So we're going to talk a bit more about that coming up in our next hour, right after a little break here. Wherever you're listening, you're up north. I once again forgot how math works. I was looking for the top of the hour. No, you're fine. Oh, boy. I am so ready for the weekend here.
Well, you got another day yet.
Yeah, I know. You going to stick around, Kristen?
I can until 7:30.
Yay. Okay. Mm-hmm. All right. I'm going to go run away for a bit here. Let's do this. Okay. I'll be back.
This is Adopt US Kids and the Adopt. I listened to a little bit of Green Day in like middle school and high school, just a little.
Yeah. I love Green Day. I saw them during the Hella Mega Tour, 2 years ago now? And I thought they were fantastic.
I should have gone, but I don't remember why I didn't. If I had a family thing or if I just didn't want to pay for it. But then immediately after the concert, some of my friends went. I was like, I should have just done it. Like, I've probably listened to them. Like, just amount of hours listened is within the probably top 3. if not just number one.
They were fantastic, and it was also Fall Out Boy and Weezer. So it was like it just kept getting better and better and better.
Right.
Yeah.
At least I have seen Weezer.
Yeah. Weezer is just they're not they're fun and they're funny.
Yes.
But like they're Green Day, they're goofy and silly. The Rivers, what's his name?
Rivers Cuomo.
Yes, is he had this hard rock guitar and this leather jacket and this giant mullet. He looked very uncomfortable and kind of nerdy, but it works for him. So it was fun. But Green Day really rocked it. We were singing and dancing and. Yeah, the whole thing was just good. And Fall Out Boy was fantastic, too.
I'm also impressed by Green Day because they can do such long concerts. And for a band that in their youth, they used a lot of drugs, they've managed to recover from that very well.
Yes.
And like Billy Joe Armstrong can still sing with an edge, but he learned how to do it right and not destroy his vocal cords.
Mm-hmm.
And they can play really long sets and they're still going.
Mm-hmm. Speaking of that, I went to go see Springsteen at Wrigley and he put on a 3.5 hour show that was so dynamic and exciting and just electrifying. The audience was having to sit down and take a break, but they were still rocking up on stage. He's 74.
Some people just don't stop, like Willie Nelson.
Mm-hmm.
He's 99, right?
Is he 99?
I think so.
Wow. Yeah. I guess when it's your thing and you love it.
Oh, he's 90, not 99. Still.
Still. That's old. And to be able to, he still plays guitar too, doesn't he?
Yeah.
Just to be that functional, to have fingers that work like that. Incredible.
If you'd like to support our scholarship and gear assistance programs or view our game schedule, please visit our website at madisongayhockey.org.
I just got tickets to go see Bob Dylan in October.
Where?
At the Riverside in Milwaukee.
Oh, wow. That will be a show. He, too, is, what, 70? No, he's 80-something, isn't he? Is Bob Dylan 80?
82.
Yeah. Wow. Order online today at knuckleheads.com. It's funny going up to Hibbing, which is really, those were his formative years. People in Hibbing are like, yep, Bob Dylan grew up here. it's almost like they don't think it's special because they're just so used to it. Yeah, I drive by his house. No big deal.
When he also just never really went back there, right?
So that's the mythology, but apparently he does feel connected to his hometown. He just doesn't spend a lot of time going back there. I mean, it's a small town on the Iron Range. It's not easy to get to. I don't think that it's a place that he, like, I love my hometown. I go to my hometown all the time. I still have friends there. I don't know that he necessarily has that, but also he's Bob Dylan. I mean, there's a giant shrine in front of his high school that talks about his Nobel Prize and has this whole other. It's just really, it would be hard to go back, I think.
Right.
We've got the smarts. When you're high, you feel different. You think different, you talk different, you draw different, you listen to music different, but you probably knew that. Problem is, you also drive different, and not in a good way. That's why driving high is illegal everywhere. So if you're high, just don't drive. Make a plan to get a sober ride. Because if you feel different, you drive different. Brought to you by NHTSA and the Ad Council.
Don't let biased algorithms or degree screens or exclusive professional networks or stereotypes. Don't let anything keep you from discovering the half of the workforce who are stars. Worker skill through alternative paths rather than a bachelor's degree.
Welcome back.
At tearthepaperceiling.org.
That was just me just welcoming you back, Pat.
Thanks. Leave
the aircraft. We don't talk about the female combat.
These are our daughters and our sisters. And
I'm just having problems with math. I thought it was 8 o'clock already.
And taught me how to stand back up and get back in the fight. The truth is, I think we all have this strength inside of us, but until you're tested, you just don't know what's there.
See how Wounded Warrior Project empowers women veterans like Beth by visiting woundedwarriorproject.org/empowerwomenvets.
Hey everybody, how we doing? I'm Charlie Behrens, inviting you to join me Saturdays and or Sundays at noon. It's a horse apiece, whatever you decide. We're doing the Cripes Cast, where we talk
20 seconds
and or from the Midwest, and it's more fun than a six-pack of Jolly Good. Okay, the pride of Random Lake, that Jolly Good is.
All across Wisconsin from Civic Media, this is Up North News Radio. Now, live from our Lake Wissota studio, here's the founding editor of Up North News, Pat Breitlow.
Saying to you, welcome back to the second hour of Up North News Radio for this Thursday, August 31st, National Eat Outside Day, National Trail Mix Day, National Cabernet Day. Nothing from Kristen
all
on that
of those
one?
Go together,
all
don't
of those.
They?
Okay, all right. National Zoo Awareness Day. I think we already covered that last hour. National Distance Learning Day. And here's one. National Matchmaker Day. Kristen and Aaron, have you ever been a matchmaker for somebody else? Or were you part of a matchmaking setup? Getting blank stares from both.
I don't
really
think so.
Okay. But in a way, I was part of a matchmaking effort in college, and they are getting married in November. So,
oh,
or no, October.
Okay.
What so is a matchmaking effort?
I just mean that one of my friends is a Marine, and he was off at boot camp. And one of my other friends introduced her friend Danielle to us. So McKinley comes back from boot camp and meets Danielle. And that first night, everyone else is like, okay, they need a date. And so we just tried to engineer situations where they would see each other more often and stuff like that. So it was not really, we didn't like introduce them like, hey, you should date. It was, we saw them together and thought, all right, let's make this
It was much more passive aggressive. It was much more like, we'll just set up the circumstances. We'll just, you know, we'll treat them like our little puppets. We won't actually say to them, you should date. We're just going to interfere in your lives until you get together. I like that. That's,
it worked.
That's very sneaky. In my case, Sherry and I were not part of a matchmaker thing, but it was an accidental thing that led us to meet. It was at a bar on Water Street in Eau Claire here, go figure. And it was a guy that I knew in college who said, I mean, I didn't know him that well, but he was like, hey, you want to go to the Water Street? Yeah, sure, let's go down. And Sherry had a friend of hers saying, hey, I'm dating this guy, but, you know, would you mind coming along with me anyway? And Sherry said, okay, we'll go down. And so I go down with my friend and Sherry goes down with her friend who are, I guess, had just started dating. And we meet at this bar. So we weren't like set up to be set up, but that couple broke up right in front of us.
Oh,
like they're talking and it's clear they both must have been thinking the same thing. Like, I'm going to bring a friend because this isn't working out. And I think both friends thought maybe we were going to accompany them out. But we were talking. We were having this really nice conversation. And so we like kept talking. We watched our friends just kind of like have a little mini argument and then leave. And we were both kind of sitting there like, so what was your name again? And we just kept talking and talking. And we talked till bar time and really hit it off well. And that all happened 40 years ago this weekend. It was Labor Day Saturday. We'll mark 40 years since our accidental matchmaking.
Well, congratulations.
Well, and thank you.
Yeah, life is funny that way. That's for sure.
It is. You know, that's how it works. Is, you know, when you're not looking for somebody necessarily is when you're going to meet somebody. I mean, there's different circumstances for everybody, but there's my matchmaker story with a nice round number attached to it. So anybody else know? Did I win the story contest this hour? Okay, I'm going to take that one. All right.
You won in many ways with that story.
I think so. Coming up this hour, just be you. Because, look, there's a lot of ugly pushback out there these days over notions of inclusivity, diversity, and acceptance. But it's only because something stronger is doing some pushing of its own. And that's the right to be yourself. Sometimes people need guidance in getting to where they think they belong versus, say, what they were assigned at birth. And so we're going to talk to a family practice physician in Green Bay about gender-affirming care that, Kristen, you introduced us to. We had to pre-tape the conversation because of her busy schedule, but we learned quite a bit from her, don't we?
Oh, yeah. She provides a service that is not very readily available in this part of the country. And she does it because she's a family medicine doc. She can provide a wide variety of different types of care. And so she can provide preventive care. She can provide hormone therapy. One of the things that I learned from this conversation is that different people are at different places with regards to their gender. This isn't just, you know, people go in to have surgery to change their bodies. They go in to seek resources to help them feel like themselves, Pat, exactly what you were just saying.
Yeah. And so Melissa Hitty is her name, and we learned a lot. And so we're looking forward to talking to her coming up down at the bottom of the hour. So that particular segment we've taped ahead of time. But for everything else that we're doing here, if you'd like to join us, 844-967-2789 is the phone number. You can email us radio@upnorthnewswi.com. Or if you're watching the live video feed of this radio show on one of several different Facebook pages, you can put a comment up there and we will put that up on screen if we see it and want to share it with the audience. As well, keep in mind that you can go to the Civic Media website, civicmedia.us, and that's where you can listen to back to past shows. Each hour is listed as a different episode, and then we bundle them together. It's all about the bundling. We bundle them as a podcast, and you can subscribe to the podcast as well, or you can listen on the Civic Media app, which is amazingly useful. And will be so again this weekend for things like high school football games and for Badger football, because some of the stations have multiple streams right there on the app that enable you to listen either to our regular programming or to a sports event that's going on right there. All right, we'll take a break right here, and then we'll get our full weatherology forecast. It's still a little brisk out there in Wisconsin, but that is going to change in a hurry with the 90s, the mid-90s, making a big comeback just in time for the holiday weekend. Wherever you're listening across Wisconsin on this beautiful Thursday morning, if you're here, you're up north. We'll be right back. You know we keep you here just for the shoulder shimmy as we're going into break.
Yes.
She's listening. She's here.
Uh-huh.
All right.
Oops.
That's okay.
I can't do math either.
Yeah.
Just one of those mornings.
See, now, when you said that, I just about had a heart attack. When you said I can't do math, I'm like, wait, are we still on? Wait, did we?
No, it was the opposite, that we had 10 seconds early because I ended at 12:50 instead of on the dot at 13.
Okay. Yeah, we are ready for the weekend here.
Yes, I love this time of year. It's like football and the weather's still nice and going back to school, all the new school supplies. It just feels like the birth of a new day.
There you go. Oh, I like that. Such energy. Oh, God, where the hell do you get that? I just don't know.
Coffee.
Goes Wisconsin with Kristen Bry.
And apparently Maggie Dawn, Big Newton.
Oh yeah.
Of the Maggie Dawn show.
As Goes Wisconsin. So that's happening this afternoon.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
I guess I better
cervix announcement.
Yes.
Do you have a topic?
It looks like Kristen has just recently updated our there are a bunch of topics. She tends to put some things in. We've got like a running Google Doc on Wednesday night, and I've been running all over the place. I left Phoenix super early yesterday morning, and it was just a long day of travel. And
it was a beautiful photo, though.
Oh my gosh, I took that while I was driving. I was just taking pictures out the window.
I wasn't going to tell anybody.
Okay. I wasn't looking. I was just taking pictures out the window. Yeah, it was stunning.
All right, here we go. So as I mentioned before, this is Glenn Tilbrook, the guitarist and lead singer for Squeeze, born in London on this day in 1957. So happy 66th birthday to Glenn Tilbrook. Also, as mentioned previously, we have one hot, hot weekend coming up just in time for the Labor Day holiday. And so here with the latest details on when that transition is going to happen, we head over to Jennifer Vuchitsky from Weatherology to tell us all about it. Jennifer, good morning.
Good morning.
So how hot is it going to get?
It's going to get really hot, especially once we get to the weekend ahead. So sunny skies and slightly warmer overall here for today as a warm front begins to push through. Mid to upper 70s for most, a little cooler around Lake Michigan. Warmer for your Friday tomorrow with that system coming in. Low to mid 80s across the board with sunny skies. Continuing to warm for the Labor Day weekend ahead. Sunny skies both days. A little warm, a little all over the place as far as temperatures are concerned for Saturday. Looks like mid 90s around Amory, Baldwin, and Richland Center. Upper 80s to low 90s around Wausau, Wisconsin Rapids, and for extreme southern Wisconsin, our coolest spot around Oshkosh with highs in the mid 80s. Sunday, everyone gets into the 90s, primarily the mid to upper 90s, so really hot one coming in. Then high pressure settles into control to start out the new week on Labor Day. Still sunny skies expected for the holiday with highs primarily in the mid to low 90s.
And yet, you look this morning, and right now it is 49 degrees up here on Lake Wissota. It's 45 in Wisconsin Rapids. It's 43 right now in Hayward. I didn't even have time to check the Ashland temperature. It's going to be a faint memory before too long, isn't it, Jennifer?
It really is, yeah. I mean, there's going to be a significant difference from today to the weekend.
Mm-hmm. Well, some of us are very much looking forward to it, and then we can make the move into fall. Jennifer, thanks so much. Have a great day.
Thanks, you too.
There's Jennifer from Weatherology. Bear with me here, because I actually do want to see where would the chilly spot be in the state right now. And I'm just guessing that it's going to be Ashland up there on the lake, but, you know.
Always a good guess.
It's always, yeah, I've been wrong before. No, not Ashland, Kentucky. Apparently, they might. Again, things just aren't working. Nope, 43 there is as well in Ashland. So
I've noticed that as I've driven to Hibbing, I take 53, so I drive that route. And when you get close to Superior, all of a sudden the temperature just nosedives.
Yes, yeah, it's like you get over that little continental divide and you're in the bowl, and boom, it just goes from there. You know, we talked to Dan Schumacher on Friday mornings, and you know, he took a new job up in Ashland not that long ago. And yeah, it's fun to watch whenever somebody moves to a new town and they get to notice some of the new things, like you, the things that you noticed in Arizona over the summer. And for him to notice that it's a lot cooler, you know, up there on the lake, on the big lake in the mornings, but in a nice way during the summer.
Absolutely. And can I tell you something really interesting that I saw in Arizona earlier this week?
Sure.
I went on a tour of the Hopi Reservation with a Hopi gentleman. It was fantastic. And I got to see things that people, white people, don't typically get to see because I had a host. And we went to this town that is the oldest continuously inhabited city town in the country, called Old Oraibi. And this is a place where the houses are made of sandstone. They're held together with mud. By our standards, they almost don't even look inhabited. They're very quiet and they're kind of sparse. And they had solar panels. I mean, it was so unexpected. Brand new solar panels. And in talking with some of the leaders, they recently dug a well. In this part of the country, they don't have running water in these homes. They have to go get their water and bring it in giant containers. So they have a well now for the first time ever. And all of this is because of President Biden's CARES Act.
Oh, sure. I mean, we've talked about the CARES Act and the American Rescue Plan and the Inflation Reduction Act. And every one of these things, you know, you get Republicans going, oh, so much spending. And I think all the rest of us, and I think the folks with the Hopi Nation would agree, it's like, no, here's that overdue investment that we were finally, you know, we've all been paying taxes. And yet, you know, instead of maybe shifting it to tax cuts for the rich, maybe you do some things for ordinary Americans, like enable us to have clean water. Seems crazy, but hey, these things are happening. Broadband expansion is happening. Again, because of the investments being made with our tax dollars, and on the list goes, which makes it, in my mind, still a little odd that, you know, the president does not have the poll numbers that maybe other people think that he should. But there's also, like I said, a lot of time between now and November of 2024 to get the message out about what's been going right versus, you know, again, years and years of neglect of, you know, of the middle class and of the people who pay taxes.
Mm-hmm. Things that we take for granted. I mean, broadband, you know, we talk about it a lot, mm-hmm. a lot of lip service. Yep. The Democrats have really come through when it comes to funding broadband and getting it implemented. And it's crazy to me to see members of the GOP taking credit for it.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, you voted against this. Mm-hmm. You don't get to climb a cell tower and talk about how great it is to have broadband. This was not your thing.
Mm-hmm. Well, and that's where you're going to see a lot more of that from President Biden on down to people saying, calling people out, basically, probably calling them out at the ribbon cuttings and things mm-hmm. like that, going, oh, it's nice of you to be here for this thing that you voted against, you know, but that you're trying to take credit for. I think that's going to be a regular feature of the next 14 months or so here. Hey, before I forget, give you the Brewers update that the Brewers lost again to the Chicago Cubs 3-2 on Wednesday afternoon. And so the Cubs take 2 out of 3 from the Brewers. Brewers still have a lead over the Cubs in the Central Division, a 3-game lead now. And it was entirely a fluke that led to the loss. Cody Bellinger hit an infield single. It should have just gone right to shortstop to throw the runner out and send the game tied into the ninth inning. But instead, it ricocheted off the ankle of Brewers relief pitcher Yoel Piamps and trickled over to third base. The runner Bellinger beat out the throw. Mike Tauschman scored from third, and that was the difference as the Cubs beat the Brewers 3-2. So now the Brewers will be at American Family Field this weekend to play the Philadelphia Phillies. We'd been hoping to give away tickets in our last hour to it. We asked what I thought was a pretty easy enough to guess question: how many Milwaukee Brewers have won a league batting title? And the answer is one, Christian Yelich. He's won it twice in 2018 and in 2019, but just one Brewer. And in fact, Kristen, if you'll indulge me, I'm going to go find there's a little bit of sports trivia involved here.
Uh-oh.
Oh, yeah. It was that Robin Yount didn't win a batting title. He, in 1982, he fell short by a single point. He had a .331 batting average while Willie Wilson had .332. Paul Molitor came in second in 1987, and that was with a franchise high batting average of .353. But Wade Boggs had hit .363 that year. Cecil Cooper finished just short to George Brett in 1980. And Ryan Braun fell just short in 2011. So Christian Yelich, the only National League batting champion, or league batting champion, I should say, in Brewers history. So now we're going to come up with something else for tomorrow, and we're going to make it 4 tickets to give away.
I love how you talked about Robin Yount and Paul Molitor and Cecil Cooper. They were all on the same team. Remember
back
in the day?
Oh, yeah.
Glory days.
Those were good times. And look, you've got a crew now that maybe isn't as – nobody's ever as legendary in the moment, but who knows how we're going to look back on some of these teams that mm-hmm. you know have made the playoffs in the past and may again this year. I mean, even if at the end of the season they say they narrowly fall behind the Cubs or the Reds in the division, they will still very much be in the wild card hunt. So there's a very good chance that we see this team going into the postseason. Different things could happen, but we'll try not to think about those things. We're going to have happy thoughts, happy positive thoughts, right?
Fingers crossed.
From now till then. One more sports note, Badger football does kick off this Saturday. Ignore what Kristen's talking about going to the Gopher game tonight. Let's talk about the Badgers.
Yeah.
They play Saturday afternoon, 2:30, and you can hear those games across several Civic Media stations, WRJN in Racine. That's 1400 AM, 99.9 and 98.1 FM. There's WFHR in Wisconsin Rapids, 1320 AM, 97.5 FM. There's WLAK in Amory, 1260 AM. And then WRCE, Richland Center, 1450 AM, 107.7 FM. And Badger football can be streamed wherever you are on the Civic Media app. So get that app downloaded and listen to some sports over the weekend. And then when you're back here Monday morning, we'll find out, whether you actually made it into the Gopher football game, or if you went to go see Duran Duran over at the State Fairgrounds. That thing's not called TCF Bank anymore, where the Gophers play, right? It's got a different
Huntington
name.
Huntington Bank now. It's Huntington Bank Stadium.
Bank?
I don't name it, Pat. I just go there.
I'm just saying. It's, you know, all the time these changes. Miller Park becomes American Family Field. You know, used to know where you were going. Now you're just going to, you know, the Brewers game or the Gophers game, and you'll have to get out there. I'm looking forward to hearing all about it here.
But Lambeau will always be Lambeau.
Lambeau will always be Lambeau. Yes. Some things, they reach a legendary status that way. So a new thing to get your thoughts about, and that is the ongoing, I don't know how else to put it, whining by the conservative justices on the state Supreme Court about the progressive justices who are now in the majority. And it seems to me their biggest problem is that they can't count to four, because there's four progressive justices who can do things that used to be done by four or five conservative justices. And that seems to be their big thing. And yet they're getting help by Republican legislators who are making noise about potentially impeaching Janet Protasiewicz, which strikes me as nothing more than trying to, again, overturn the results of an election, which, again, sounds pretty typical for what we're getting from the Republicans these days, is if you don't like an election, try to overturn it.
Remind me what the margin was on that election. Like, 11. Was it a squeaker?
Not even close. It was an 11-point victory for Janet Protasiewicz, who did say that the current maps are rigged. And here's why she said it. It's true. It's been borne out over and over and over again.
Yeah.
And
can we talk about this? Like, I think it's good to share your, like, we all have opinions. So she is sharing her personal opinion, which is based in fact. And I think that's very reasonable. She's a human who lives on the earth.
Not to mention that plenty of Republican legislators have bragged about the condition of the maps. And look, one of our own here at Civic Media, Todd Alba, was in the room as a Republican staffer when they were bragging about how, you know, those new maps in 2011 were going to lock in a majority because they knew they were gerrymandered. So, yeah, the jig is finally up. And so to act as if you're going to again try to nullify the results of an election, I guess, let me put it this way, folks, I dare you. Go for that. See how that strategy works with the voters. I don't think it's going to work out well for you. That's just my guess.
I'm with you.
I know. I know you got to run. We're going to do the taped interview for Hometown Health coming up next. So, hey, you have a wonderful time. Safe travels. We'll talk Monday morning.
Looking forward to it.
All right. Kristen and I are back with Hometown Health coming up right after this break, talking about gender-affirming care. You're up north.
Are we on Monday? Because it's Labor Day.
Oh, Jesus, Kristen.
That's correct. We are not on Monday.
Well, now, apparently it's not just math and it's not just words. It's the whole damn calendar.
Although, the audience will still hear you on Monday because we're going to replay today.
Oh, God. So there, on Monday, they're going to hear Thursday and go, hey, doofus. Yeah. All right. Well, I got to give Luke something because he won't have you to play with. So I got to give him something to club me over the head with. So we're going to start with that.
You guys enjoy that. I'm going to take little Pat Kreitlow to school and it's going to be amazing. I'm so excited.
You run away. Call me later.
Mwah, bye. Okay,
bye.
Adios.
Reported in the state last night.
ABC's M1, 3 storm-related deaths reported. In Johannesburg, South Africa, at least 73 dead and counting in an abandoned apartment building fire. Investigators believe the victims were squatters. This is ABC News.
I even went to bed a little bit early last night, and I am just not awake.
No, I am so ready for this weekend. All right, I'll be back.
sign want to bug you?
Right. How many times have you heard me say don't call the sign?
All of them.
You called the agent working for the seller, and once you see the property with that agent, I'm no longer free to write an offer on it.
So
you need to hire us from the beginning, help you find the right home, negotiate on your behalf, and protect your interests all the way through the process, and it shouldn't cost you a dime.
Solidarity Realty. They're real, they're solid, and they're honest. Find them at SolidarityRealty.com.
Hey, Brad from Zero Res Madison here. What's the best way to clean your carpet? Well, not surprisingly, it's the same way you clean your clothes. You wouldn't clean a dirty shirt by running a white cloth over the top of it, nor would you try to get it clean by sprinkling chemicals and rubbing it in. For a real clean, you need hot water, agitation, and a cleaning agent, just like your laundry. For a fresh, healthy clean with no residue, call Zero Res Madison or schedule online. Zero Res, spell it forward or backward, it's the right way to clean.
This is Chad Spate. In 1992, I moved to Madison to pursue a PhD at UW, and I started a residential remodeling company called Chad's Carpentry. I was eager to make a difference, to change the world, and I soon realized that our remodeling company was a great place to start. We pride ourselves on understanding how houses work so that your home improvement project actually improves your home, and we love what we do. To learn more, go to chadsdesignbuild.com, and thank you, Madison, for 30 great years.
Do you have Flex or Health Savings Account money available? The team at Ula Eyewear would love to help you put those dollars towards something stylish, useful, and fun. Ula Eyewear has been family-owned and operated for nearly 25 years. Ula prides itself on pairing excellent customer service with unique quality and eye-catching eyewear options for everyone. So invest in you and the eyewear you want by visiting Ula Eyewear today at Hilldale Shopping Center in Madison. Learn more about their selection and reframed initiative at ulaeyewear.com.
Radio keeps your community informed, entertained, and connected. It's what we're all about at the Civic Media Network of local radio stations.
We're having fun and moving fast to preserve hometown radio across Wisconsin.
This includes a commitment to news.
Now we want to invite you to join Civic Media's exclusive Facebook group, Wisconsin Breaking News. It's a place to share your community's news and chat with others from across the state about it.
Join the Facebook group, Wisconsin Breaking News, today. It's the perfect companion to your local Civic Media radio station.
It's back to school time, but before...
My mama told me when I was young, we're all on superstars.
And welcome back. It's time for Hometown Health on this Thursday. As always, Dr. Kristen Lyerly joins us with a guest and always a very interesting topic. And the topic this week is gender-affirming care. Dr. Lyerly, how are you?
I'm great. How are you?
Good, thanks. Now, let's talk about the subject today. And then we have a great family medicine doc from the Green Bay area that you're going to introduce, not just as a doc, but I like that your introduction refers to Dr. Melissa Hitty as mom, Packer fan, cross stitcher, and provides transgender hormone therapy for some of your patients. That is a full business.
She does
card.
It all. Yes. Yeah, she does it all. So, yeah, I wanted to bring Dr. Hitty on board because we've had many conversations. We care for a lot of the same patients and a lot of the same issues. And Dr. Hitty is really kind of a unicorn in the Green Bay area. She is an essential resource for lots of folks who live here. And it's just such a privilege to know her and to work with her. Welcome, Dr. Melissa Hitty.
Thank you. Good morning.
So why don't we start out by talking about doctors who provide these much needed services for transgender folks. And like I mentioned in the introduction, there just aren't a lot of people who offer this kind of care. How did this become part of your practice?
So the really short answer to that is really because there was a need. I came from a very, very small town. And when I went to college at Madison, sort of had my eyes opened, took, a gender studies class. And then in our medical school, we actually had a class titled Healthcare in Diverse Communities. So had a small introduction to transgender medicine and what that could look like. When I got to residency, every year the outgoing residents graduate and they hand down all their patients to the incoming residents. And I had a patient that was assigned to me that was transgender, and I didn't want to not know what I was doing. So from there, I just started seeking out more education. I had a great mentor in my residency. I was able to get a lot of the education that I was looking for. And my residency program was very, very supportive and let me grow a little bit of this practice in my residency. And then I was just able to take that with me to where I am now in Green Bay and grow it more.
And that was the Appleton area, right?
Yeah, I was right in Appleton and was really fortunate to have some great, not only mentors, but just a ton of support, both with my colleagues and the clinic I was at. They not only said, oh, sure, you can do it, but said, hey, what do you need and how can we help grow this and really make sure that our clinic is a safe space for these patients?
And now you're practicing in Green Bay, which is, you know, fairly close to Appleton, although those of us who live in Green Bay and Appleton feel like it's a world apart sometimes. So where do your patients come from and how do they find you?
When I first started, I had a lot of patients follow me from Appleton. It's not that far. And as you mentioned, there's just not a lot of folks who feel really comfortable and confident providing complete gender-affirming care. When I started here, we put it in all my marketing materials and we went to a few local events, but really a lot of my patients from the area that grew really via word of mouth. And then now I have patients that really are from across the state. I have patients from very far up north. I have patients from, you know, Eau Claire, La Crosse. I have some patients that have moved to Milwaukee and Madison and keep me as their physician. I actually got licensed in Michigan solely so that I could help care for folks up in the Upper Peninsula of Michigan. Because again, there's just not a lot of opportunities for these patients to get care without seeking out like an academic center or going to a place like Howard Brown in Chicago.
So for folks who are patients, let's go back a step. People who might become, you know, they're prospective patients, they just need to talk to somebody. Does that talking to other people happen before they get to the stage of reaching out to you and making an appointment with you? Or do you, is your first appointment sometimes a lot of, you know, taking the patient's history and listening to them and then determining a path forward?
Yeah, it depends. Some patients come to me and I'm sort of the very last step in their pathway to maybe hormone therapy or further things. And I have a lot of patients who come to me just because they know we've created the safe space and we have a really welcoming and inclusive clinic. Because I'm a family doctor, I can take care of anybody. So whether it's regular checkups and routine healthcare, or whether it is talking about more specialized things like gender-affirming hormone therapy, we can take care of all of that right in my clinic. So I meet people at every single stage in this journey, from people who haven't quite figured everything out yet to people who have just been trying to find somebody to prescribe their medications and then finally stumble upon me.
We took a step back with that question, but let's take another step back because we didn't really define what gender affirming care is. Help us.
Yeah. So really at its roots, gender affirming care is simply anything that helps affirm somebody's gender. So if somebody asks to use a preferred name or certainly using somebody's pronouns that they feel comfortable with, those are two very, very simple and what I often tell parents, completely reversible things that can be done. And there's a lot of evidence that shows using affirming language, so using a preferred name, using the right pronouns, is really, truly beneficial to patients' mental health and their overall well-being. What we see is gender-affirming care could simply be that, just language that we use, allowing people to be themselves, dress the way that they choose. I think a lot of people, when they think gender-affirming care, they jump right to medications and hormones. But truly, a lot of it's just inclusive language and having an environment where people are allowed to be themselves. And then, of course, gender-affirming care may, for some people, eventually include surgeries. But some people pursue that and some don't. So it's just this entire idea of being welcoming, inclusive, mirroring the language that a person is using themselves to help them really feel their best and feel their most confident.
It's good to know that we can now talk about this as essentially a spectrum or an arc, if you will, that once upon a time it was just sex change, or it was, you know, they're a cross dresser or whatever. But in each stage, it's affirming somebody's gender, and not everybody takes it, you know, to the point of surgery. Like you said, sometimes it's just the verbal recognition. In other ways, it might be, you know, wardrobe, it might be hormones, things like that. So you have these discussions with a patient or a prospective patient. And so what in your office, obviously you said if it's surgery, you move on to another area, another specialty, but what are some of the other kinds of things that happen in terms of, you know, say hormone therapy?
Yeah. So in my clinic, when somebody comes to see me, a lot of times we talk about steps of readiness. So for my patients, if they're planning to move toward hormone therapy, first, what we want to see is we want to see that very clear diagnosis of gender dysphoria. So gender dysphoria is a very persistent, you know, so well over 6 months of feeling very strongly like the outside body, the body parts, the chromosomes that one was given don't match with who they are, and really wishing that they and others could see themselves as another gender. So once we've got that well-defined diagnosis, then a lot of patients will move forward with a social transition. So that may be trying to find the right name or trying to use pronouns that are the best fit. For some people, that's things like changing their clothing or their hairstyle. Sometimes for people that have breast tissue or chest tissue, that's wearing a binder to help flatten that so that their outward appearance isn't as overtly feminine and maybe looks a little bit more masculine. And there's truly a lot of things that people can do in their life that are kind of figuring this out. And again, finding what things make me feel my best and maybe which things aren't a good fit. So that part of things often people have been figuring out for a long time before they come to see me. In my office, like you said, we get a really complete history. So usually our visits are pretty long in the world of primary care. I often will take 45 to 60 minutes with a patient, our first meeting, and I really just want to hear their whole story. I want to make sure that from a physical standpoint, they're overall healthy, making sure, you know, maybe we have some high blood pressure we need to get under control, or maybe we have some headaches we need to work on. And then really the last step before we talk about hormones is making sure that mental health is steady. So that doesn't mean people can't have depression or anxiety, because obviously we see really high rates of mental health diagnoses and conditions in people that are gender diverse. But what it means is I want people to have a stable mental health, that maybe their medications have been consistent for a while, they've been following their treatment plan, we don't have any active suicidal thoughts. It's been a long time since we've self-harmed. For a lot of people, that means having a counselor, maybe a psychiatrist. And truly for a lot of people, it just means having people, right? Safe people, whether that's family or friends or a found family, knowing that they have support so that as they're going through this journey, when there's little ups and downs, we know we've got a good safety net for that. And then from there, that's where if we've met all those milestones, a lot of people are ready to start talking about hormone therapy and what that can do to help their body better align with who they truly are.
This is a long process that starts with a history and goes through all of the things that you just talked about. So have you encountered a situation where someone wants to change their gender in order to participate in sports for as a differently gendered person? Just out of curiosity, because we hear a lot about that in politics and in political speech.
So I can confidently tell you of the thousands of patients that I care for, I have had absolutely zero who have chosen to change their gender, right? Because gender is written, it's rooted in the brain. And I certainly haven't had any who've wanted to change their gender for some ulterior motive or some outside gain. There are very exceedingly rare exceptions where somebody may have symptoms that kind of look like gender dysphoria, but there's something else. And that's where working with me, working with the team, working with a lot of folks in the area who take care for a lot of gender diverse patients can help guide those folks. This is just who people are. As somebody's written either left-handed or right-handed, gender is written in the brain. So I think one of the best analogies I've ever heard is if you're left-handed, right? And there's a small percentage of the population who are. Imagine being forced to use your right hand your whole life, being told you're right-handed, not being allowed to use your left hand or only being able to do it in secret. And just imagine one day being finally able to use your truly dominant hand, to actually use it and actually be confident in that. So similar to handedness, gender, you know, we can play along and we can maybe get kind of good at using the wrong hand for a while, but we just can't unwrite that. So this isn't people in a dress trying to sneak into a bathroom. This isn't people trying to gain some advantage in sports. These are just people who are trying to go about their day, go about their life, go about their job, but just feel their best.
Sounds good. And if people want more information, if they're looking for more assistance, what other kinds of things could people do if they want more answers?
So in Wisconsin, the forgewisconsin.org has a great set of resources for folks who are looking maybe for a doctor, but other resources in Wisconsin. So we have folks that have a hair salon who can help maybe teach people how to shave or do their hair in a certain way if maybe they didn't learn that when they were younger. We have local tattoo artists who can help with chest or nipple tattooing after chest surgeries. There's just a huge array. In the Green Bay area, there's a couple of wonderful support groups. Diverse and Resilient is one that we have a lot of patients get some wonderful support from. And then, unfortunately, this is somewhat political and there's a lot of legal aspects to this. So we use the Trans Law Help website and the Trans Law Wisconsin website a lot to help with things like name changes and gender marker changes, but also with things like what to do if you were discriminated against with housing or with a job, and what resources are out there.
Very good. Dr. Melissa Hitty, thank you so much. Kristen, thanks again for helping introduce us to the topic here on Up North News Radio. Hope you have a great day. And I should note that in that interview that we taped ahead of time with the doctors there, that right before that, I said to Kristen, see you on Monday. No, we won't. Monday's Labor Day. And we'll talk more about Labor Day weekend with Luke Mathers coming up in just a minute. You're up north.
Luke Mathers,
executive producer.
Did we lose the doctor? Is the doctor out?
Yes, she had to go. Yes.
Oh.
Yep, first day of high school for her youngest.
So. Ah.
Which, I don't know, first day of high school, does it mean you have to walk them into school and they sit in a circle and the teacher sings a song to them?
I think that's when you're not allowed to walk them into school anymore.
Right. Mom! Yeah. Mom, stop it.
How are we doing? Did we give the Brewers tickets away? I heard
We did not. So we're going to do four of them tomorrow, or we won't. You know.
Or Aaron's going to the game.
Yes.
we tried to give them away.
Yeah. I was going to say I heard the final segment of the last hour. So kept asking. Is it three or four?
Neither.
Really?
It's one.
Christian only Yelich. One. Yelly's the only one.
Yeah, at least the only one. And we later talked about all of them that came very close.
Gotcha.
Mm-hmm. I thought this was the Letterman, but I was wrong. It's, was it The Happenings? I think is the name
it's
of the group.
The Happenings.
I was sure it was the Letterman, and I ended up with some other terrible song about September. And it, this is the one I was looking for, because this is it for August, Luke. It's going to be September tomorrow.
Come
you
on,
your sweat, have... you got a sweatshirt on already.
It was it's cool down here. When
what
I woke
are
up
you
this
talking
morning?
About? Aaron comes in every day looking like he just stepped out of a Turkish bathhouse because it's so hot in there. And you're
you have your
a
robe.
Sweatshirt.
You have your robe in the studio, Aaron.
No, just a little towel. You... It's like a dish towel. Could we please fix that?
You miss a lot when you don't get here at 5:45, but maybe that's for the best.
Yeah,
there you go.
Yeah.
So yeah, it's actually it's a cool morning. Cool. I slept with the house open last night, so I was just a little cooler this morning myself. So, yeah, I'm repping Door County.
The Door County sweatshirt there.
Yeah.
No, so, it has been. It's been very chilly, but it's going to be a hot, hot weekend. What are you going to do with it?
I'm going up to Door County.
Door so County. All right.
That's where I'll be. This Labor Day weekend, it's a family tradition, so we go up there the entire extended family on my mom's side. We go up to the same campsite every year. So it'll be a great time. Looking forward to it. Hopefully it's not 90 degrees while I'm sleeping in a tent, but you know, if it is, it is.
Not while you're sleeping, but still. So this is all on your side and you're newly married. So will your bride come along? Is she aware of this? Is she aware of it and saying, you know,
she's been coming
you go do your thing.
Year.
Okay.
Oh, no. She's been coming every year, for better part of 7-8 years now. It's been a while. So
this woman has stuck around with you for 7-8 years now.
It'll be 10 years come next March, but she didn't come to Door County every single year. So
I would be impressed with the 10 years, except that you heard my story earlier about, you know, Sherry and I mark 40 years this weekend. So you got a little ways to go, but on the other hand, you know, once you get to 40, you also never have to have an alarm set at 4 a.m. because you're always waking up that early to pee anyway. So enjoy your youth, young man, while you've got it.
Well, see, I got the dog helps me stick on the morning schedule, because even on an off day, I get to still be up, because he's like, hey, I don't know what the difference between a Monday and a Saturday is.
So I'm just going to do that jingle thing on my collar, you know, till you wake up and take me out. Or if they really need to get you going, you know what the dogs do then? They go...
No, but he does a low. He talks.
There is
through, like,
nothing that wakes
growl.
You up. Nothing wakes you up like a dog that you think is about to vomit. You hear that, and you're just
that
like, nope.
It's never happened before. But Remy's a pretty good boy. He doesn't throw up anywhere. Like he eats his food. He doesn't get into things that would cause him to throw up. So his thing, he'll come and he just does a little low growl. So it's just
again,
and
just
that's
to,
all he does.
Just to recap, so far this segment has been filled with dog vomit, old men peeing, and Aaron wearing a dish towel. So we're...
Hey man, your name's on the show. Your name's on the show.
So for the holiday weekend, I know we've got Badger football. We've talked about all the stations across the Civic Media Network where that can be heard. I would imagine there's going to be a Cripes cast or two, perhaps. Yes?
Yeah. Should be at least one at noon on both Saturday and Sunday. Aaron's got the details on that one today, because I haven't received them yet.
Yes, this weekend's Cripes cast is a little different from normal. Normally, he has some guests, but this time, you know, doing the Cripes cast for a while, he's built up a lot of listener questions. So he has a Q&A.
Oh, a mailbag edition.
Yeah,
I like
learned
it.
Some stuff about the Midwest, which we already know, but get his perspective, some stuff about birding, fishing, all the good stuff.
There we go.
Birding.
Speaking of birding, Bird on a Wire is also new this weekend.
Oh,
so
I see what you did there.
WAUK, the Shaw in Waukesha. You can listen to Bird on the Wire with host Luann Bird. She's sitting down for a conversation with her siblings, Mike, John, Phil, and Joe, who all served in the military. So a military-themed edition of Bird on the Wire, service edition for this Labor Day weekend.
Wait, so she gets to talk to her siblings on the radio. Charlie Behrens has made a great franchise out of talking to his siblings on the radio. My two younger sisters would not give me the time of day if I asked them to sit. They'd say, are you nuts?
You can
no
float the
way.
Idea this Labor Day weekend. Come on. You just ask. You never know until you ask.
No, the person who would do it would be my mom. But again, we would put the radio station license in jeopardy because she's taught my granddaughters my daughters and my grandkids just too many bad words. But God love her for it. You know, that one of us has to respect the red light when it's on, man. If you're on TV or radio, respect the red light.
Yes.
Yes. Her, not so much. She'll blow right through that thing.
Not everybody's trained for the broadcast world, Pat.
No, they most definitely are not. All right, so we covered. We didn't get to talk to about high school sports very much, but needless to say, high school football season is well underway and in full yes. gear on many of these civic media stations.
Yeah, full swing for the high school sports. No other place but bigger, doing more high school sports here on the Civic Media Network than Pull Falls Radio. Chad Holmes with the big high school sports show on Wednesday evenings and covering like three different concurrent streams all at once. Like, I don't know how Chad does it sometimes. I am always impressed with the work that Chad and the team at Pull Falls Radio is doing when it comes to high school sports coverage. But we've got excellent high school sports through Richland Center, Waukesha, Wisconsin Rep, like it is everywhere. We've got high school sports coverage, so you can check out the Civic Media website to see more about all of that coverage.
He's the red zone. That's what it is.
Oh, Aaron, that's a great comparison.
Aaron,
I haven't even thought of that yet.
Our walk-up music for Chad Holmes has been, you know, the old Johnny Cash tune, I've Been Everywhere, because he goes all over the place doing these football games. We had to get the theme song to the red zone. It's like this big orchestral thing, like, no, 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 because that's him. Oh, yeah. He's like the red zone of high school football in Wisconsin.
I think we'll have to do that, yeah.
Yep. Well, Scott Hansen and the NFL Network might be a little upset with you, but we could try to do it.
5 seconds.
Little tease. Yeah. Just a little sample.
Or maybe I can record an off-brand version.
Just play it with a kazoo. You know,
there you go. You got the drums and the bass from your Green Day.
I'm not sure that this is going to work after all. I'd like to pull back this plan. Let's cut this part out in post-production. Nah, live.
He's going to work on it all Labor Day weekend, and it'll be perfect next week when Chad joins you next week.
All right. Well, look, now that I've got an extra moment here, I very rarely get to do this. There are so many things going on across the Civic Media Radio Network at 8 o'clock in the morning. And so I'm just going to go through all of them, and either one of you can interrupt and say something about them. But depending on where you're listening, and Luke will correct me if I get any of these wrong. It's like a pop quiz. Earl Ingram is coming up next in Waukesha, Green Bay, and Racine. Stu Daniels in the Chippewa Valley, La Crosse, Hayward, and Oshkosh. Chad Holmes in Wausau. Stephanie Miller in Madison. James Jay and the gang in Wisconsin Rapids. And they are all followed by Kristen Bry and As Goes Wisconsin. How, as an executive producer, Mr. Mathers, do you possibly juggle all of this quality talent one time block?
I just help with the production side of things. We've got an excellent team here at Civic Media working out on the programming side. It has been a very great last year. Looking forward to all of the new additions to the team to help continue expanding local programming here in the state of Wisconsin. And yeah, we're going to have a little special Labor Day broadcast as well for individuals. On Monday, 8 to 11 a.m., the Earl Ingram Show is going to be live from Labor Fest. So a little extended bonus Earl on the Labor Day holiday that you can tune into on Monday.
Look at you. All right. Such a good company, man. Have a great weekend. Talk to you later. We'll see the rest of you all here tomorrow on Friday morning, where it'll be another beautiful day up north. See you then.
All right.
Adios. All right.
See you later.